Hello, and welcome to a walk through the history of the Waterbury Dam in honor of National Dam Safety Awareness Day. In recognition of this day on May 31st, we highlight the importance of understanding the value of dam safety, the role various parties play, and current dam safety issues. My name is Katherine, and I am an ECO AmeriCorps member serving with the State of Vermont Dam Safety Program. I will be your guide today. The tour will lead you across the crest of the Waterbury Dam and point out clues to different eras in the history of the dam. The tour begins at the top of Little River Road, looking east across the top of the dam, with the Waterbury Reservoir stretching out to the left. Waterbury Dam is an important facility as it provides flood risk reduction and supports hydropower production and recreation. Here at Waterbury Dam, the State of Vermont Dam Safety Program serves as the dam caretaker, operator, and owner representative on behalf of the state. Waterbury is one of the largest dams in the state. It comes in at the third tallest dam with the fourth greatest storage capacity. This is the largest dam owned by the state and operated by the Dam Safety Program. The Dam Safety Program is similarly responsible for the two other Winooski River flood control dams, Wrightsville Dam in East Montpelier and East Barry Dam in Barry Town, as well as 11 additional state-owned dams. The program also serves as the primary dam safety regulator in the state, regulating approximately 1,000 dams through inspection, oversight, permitting, and technical assistance. We will begin by orienting you to the different parts of the dam that we will be walking you through. First, notice the slopes extending on either side of the road on the crest of the dam. This is called the embankment. Where the embankment meets the natural hills perpendicular to the dam are called the abutments. This tour begins at the right abutment on the western side of the dam. The principal and emergency spillways are at the eastern abutment on the opposite side of the dam from our starting point. An outlet tunnel begins under the water's surface upstream of the dam and extends through the embankment, releasing on the downstream side. Before construction of the Waterbury Dam, the Little River flowed through the valley with contributions from the top of Mount Mansfield to the north, the Wister Range to the east, and Green Mountains to the west, making up a drainage area of 109 square miles. It may be deceiving as the reservoir is approximately 100 feet deep at the dam, but before the dam was built, there was a small farming community in this valley. The Little River passed through the location of the dam through a deep gorge and waterfall feature cut into the bedrock. This gorge and other challenging geologic conditions have led to the need for dam rehabilitation projects in the past and continue to plague the dam to this day. Original plans for the dam, as well as sister flood control dams Wrightsville Dam and East Barry Dam, were devised following the November 1927 flood. The 1927 flood resulted in the loss of 84 lives in Vermont, including 55 people in the Winooski River Basin alone. The flood caused over $13.5 million in damages in the Winooski River Basin. This prompted the design of the three aforementioned Winooski River flood control dams. However, in 1931, the proposed dams were determined to not be economically justified based on a cost-benefit analysis. But in 1933, with the onset of the Great Depression and need to provide employment, the decision was made to construct the three flood control projects. Land for Waterbury Dam was provided by the State of Vermont and Green Mountain Power, and the project was constructed between 1935 and 1938 by the Civilian Conservation Corps under technical supervision of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. Ownership of the dam was then passed to the State of Vermont with an ongoing project cooperative agreement with the Army Corps of Engineers. Since the original construction of the dam, there have been several projects and updates. In the 1950s, the embankment was raised 3 feet. As you can see, the rocks on the embankment, called riprap, are laid more loosely and at a slightly steeper grade at the top of the slopes than the rest of the embankment. You can tell the difference between the original laid riprap, which was hand-placed and appears to fit together like a puzzle. This is in contrast to machine-placed riprap that is looser and randomly placed. After original construction, all other modifications to the dam involved machine-placed riprap. As part of this 1950s upgrade, a third gate was added to the principal spillway, which we will see later. Another part of this project was the installation of the 5-megawatt power station, constructed by Green Mountain Power. This is housed in the green building at the base of the dam on the downstream side. In the 1980s, following safety concerns tied to seepage and stability of the dam, improvements were made to collect seepage moving through the dam. This project involved injecting sand, pea stone filter materials, and grout into the downstream slope and wells, as well as increasing the outlet capacity of the drainage system through the addition of a 48-inch penstock to discharge extra flow. As you move along the crest of the dam, you will notice areas of disturbed riprap to the right on the downstream slope. In this area, the riprap is randomly placed, and there may be some vegetation growing between rocks. This reveals areas in the slope that were disturbed during this improvement project, disrupting the hand-laid riprap of original construction. During this same project, issues associated with the gorge area, or the original river alignment beneath the dam, were discovered and later addressed. A seepage control project in the early 2000s addressed issues with this area. As noted above, Waterbury Dam was built on top of a natural gorge in the Little River with steep rock slopes. Similar formations can be observed downstream of the dam on the Angler's Trail along Little River Road. During the previous 1980s studies, it was determined that the geologic anomalies in the gorge area were causing internal erosion to the dam. To address this issue, wells were installed to pull water out of the dam and lower the groundwater in the gorge area. An attempt was also made to build an internal wall to prevent seepage through the gorge area. However, this project was abandoned due to inability to seal the wall and build the wall low enough in the dam. The dewatering wells still function today to address seepage through the gorge area. The wells can be seen on the platform on the downstream side of the dam. The 4 manholes you can see in a line intersect the gorge and pump seepage water out and through the pump house, the small concrete building adjacent to the wells. As you continue along the crest, the road forks off to the right and downhill. This leads to the well platform. Wells are beneath the manholes on this terrace. Inside the building, our pump house, are controls and monitoring systems for the wells, which are checked regularly. The most recent modifications at the dam occurred in 2018. This was called the Green Mountain Power Bypass Project, in which the hydroplant was converted from a peaking operation, meaning it only ran when there was high demand for electrical power, such as in the mornings or evenings, to a run-of-river operation, meaning there is always some level of flow moving through the plant, which contributes to electrical baseload. To accomplish this, 2 automated flow bypass pipes were installed to allow constant outflow from the dam, greater operational control, as well as turbine runner improvements. This building on the crest is called the Gatehouse, housing a diesel generator capable of 50 kilowatts. In the event of a power outage, the generator could operate the gates in the principal spillway, the vertical lift gate inside the gatehouse, and the aforementioned well pumps. A vertical gate inside this building is responsible for controlling flow through the outlet tunnel of the dam to the power station below. The gate weighs over 40,000 pounds and takes 1 hour and 20 minutes to lower the 130 feet to the bottom and close the flow through the dam. Beyond the fence at the left abutment, you will see the emergency spillway and 3 radial arm tainer gates in the principal spillway. The gates, currently in the upright position, can be lowered to allow for a greater storage of water in the Waterbury Reservoir. These gates prevent water from flowing through the spillway during flood conditions, preventing flooding from occurring downstream. When opened, the emergency and principal spillways have a capacity to pass 84,000 cubic feet of water per second. That's about equivalent to 25 school buses of water passing through every second. A project is currently underway to replace the current gates, which have degraded concrete and have been determined to be structurally deficient. This project is currently estimated at $60 million and should be designed, permitted, and constructed in the next 10 years. The Waterbury Dam is a high-hazard potential dam. This means that failure is expected to result in loss of life and extensive damage to property and infrastructure downstream. In the event of a full failure, it has been estimated that over 1,400 structures would be inundated and the population at risk could be up to 5,000 people, with a potential loss of life up to 820 people. This includes the town of Waterbury, located several miles downstream, which would be heavily damaged by a dam failure. The State Emergency Operations Center in Waterbury is also located in the failure path. As the owner representative of the dam, the State of Vermont Dam Safety Program has a variety of responsibilities in looking after this dam. This includes weekly site visits by the program, monthly instrumentation analysis, quarterly testing of the tainer gates, and manual instrumentation readings, as well as other annual and biannual inspections and maintenance of the dam. The program has similar responsibilities at Wrightsville Dam, East Barry Dam, and other state-owned dams. In addition, the work of the Dam Safety Program in regulating the over 1,000 Vermont dams through inspection, oversight, permitting, and technical assistance is critical in keeping these structures safe and operational across the state. On May 31st, we joined to commemorate National Dam Safety Awareness Day. On this day, we remember the lessons learned from past dam failures, push for strong dam safety programs, encourage investment in America's critical infrastructure, and rededicate ourselves to the effective public-private partnerships that work to keep America's dams safe, operational, and resilient. The issue of dam safety was not widely recognized until 1889, when the failure of the South Fork Dam near Johnstown, Pennsylvania, claimed more than 2,200 lives. As we observe the 132nd anniversary of this tragedy on May 31st, 2021, we encourage you to understand the importance of dam safety, the role various parties play, and current dam safety issues. On days like this, it is important to recognize the history that stands around us and invest in our future safety and enjoyment of the resources dams provide. Interested in learning more about the dam safety world? Head to dec.vermont.gov/dam-safety to learn more about the Vermont Dam Safety Program and Vermont-owned dams. You can also visit damsafety.org/NDSAD to learn more about the safety of dams across the country. If you are at the dam or wish to visit, also consider checking out trails on Little River Road, including the Camp Smith Interpretive Trail through the old CCC camp and the Angler's Trail to see gorge structures similar to those beneath the dam. You can also continue up Little River Road into Little River State Park, where more walking trails abound, or take to the reservoir for a paddle. Thank you for spending your time with us and learning about the past, present, and future of dam safety in Vermont.